Welcome everybody. I know that outside was much better than here. Maybe if you manage to organize other meeting, we can consider that in the future to be outside. So welcome to our third session, Sacrifice, Conversion and Idolatry. I'm Carlo Taviani, I'm a research associate here at Itatti. I am an economic historian and works on trade diaspora, Italian diaspora between West Africa and the New World. So I'm very much interested in looking at your conference, to keep an eye on the New World, and to see process of hybridization, transformation. I usually study economic institutions, but I mean, what you were speaking about today, conversion is a process of hybridization, transformation. And we will start with Jens Baumgarten. Yesterday we already speak about idolatry, at least in two papers. Tom and Patrick mentioned that, and today there is one of the important topic of your conference, of our conference, conversion. So Jens studied art history and history in Hamburg and Florence. And after postdoctorate fellowship in Dresden, Mexico City, and Campinas, Brazil, he became professor of art history at the history department of the Federal University of Sao Paulo, Universidade Federal de Sao Paulo, where he later established one of the first autonomous departments of art history in Brazil. In 2010, he was visiting scholar at the Getty Research Institute. He is member of the Brazilian Committee of Art History and specializes in early modern art history of Latin America and Europe, as well as in historiography of art, visual culture, and its theoretical and methodological context. He's author of Image, Confession, and Power in German, several articles, and is preparing a book on visual systems in colonial Brazil, and I read Sao Paulo as a New Baroque City, which are two books. So, Jens, thank you.
Thank you very much for the very kind introduction, and also I'm very grateful and happy to be here. Thank you, Alina and Thomas, for the wonderful organization and for the possibility. And thank you, Maria, for the organization and stimulation intellectually and also personally. I'm very happy to be here. So the title is very generic, and that had a reason, because I was really struggling a little bit with what I want to talk today. So my talk is a little bit eclectic, and as it was really much too long, so I'm looking for the time, and I asked also, please tell me when I'm going over the time. So I want to to bring back some questions we have discussed in the exploratory seminar, because I think that's the general theological question. And on the other hand, I would like to present some other examples, especially about conversion, which comes together. So let me start. The importance of the discourse about the images, as you all know, constitutes the focus of this presentation. It includes the post-Tridentine debate in Italy and its reception in Portugal and its colonies. In the Historical Council of Trent, in its penultimate session in 1563, set up a new vision of the images, which in the decades later were developed by the theologians like Carlo Borromeo, Gabriele Paliotti, and Roberto Bellarmino. Their theology of visibility, how I would call it, led to a new understanding of the sacred art, and especially in relation to social political questions. The new understanding and concept of the images was connected with a new vision of society. And it lacks actually, I would say, how this is also related. The Council of Trent has received, actually, the questions from the New World. The perception, or rather the different discourses about the images in the Portuguese-speaking world and their relations to the Italian post-Tridentine debate were rather disregarded. This concerns today rather less known theologians like the influential Archbishop of Braga, the Dominican from the Dominican order Bartholomew of Braga or Bartholomeus Martyribus, and some 100 years later, the famous Jesuit author Antonio Vieira. I will not speak a lot of Antonio Vieira today. Perhaps we can do this in the discussion. It is necessary to take into account their significance in both a European context and a Brazilian context in order to understand the complexity of the transfer of ideas and objects. This can also be linked on a theoretical level with Hartmut Böhme's cultural historical analysis of fetishism and Karl-Heinz Kohl's writings on the history and theory of sacred objects. Böhme in particular points to the fetishistic character of post-classical European culture in political context, where things were not merely symbols, but were also believed to have magical powers of their own. Understanding does not come about through cognitive acts of decoding, but in shared processing. Processing is the realization of meaning. That is what makes fetishes and idols so interesting for the political powers that be. Böhme attributes a particular status to relics, and it is accordingly not surprising that particular importance attached to their particular notable use in the sacred conquest of Latin America, in quotation marks. For example, as one of the first decisions for the capital of the viceroyalty, Salvador, panel paintings and relics were imported to raise the status of the Jesuit church. Salvador, in fact, provides outstanding evidence of the importance of relics in the transfer of cultural objects. The role of a patron saint, both in the city where the governor resided and in other cities in colonial Brazil, was fulfilled by the 11,000 virgins. This presented the perfect opportunity to import a wide range of relics and bones into Brazil, which were available due to the desecration of several churches in the Protestant territories. So also, it is very important to understand, which is a very complicated thing, because people who work on the Europe Protestant-Catholic wars don't know Latin America, and Latin Americanists are not well known what is going on in Europe and how these questions are connected. The Jesuit played a particular part in this, as they did with regard to the veneration of saints and relics. José de Anchieta, the provincial father, named his ship after St. Ursula, one of the leaders of the 11,000 virgins, and Antonio Vieira often referred in his sermons to Santa Ursula and the importance the crown attached for her to the conversion of indigenous peoples in Brazil. Already, the also Jesuit José de Anchieta wrote an important play in the indigenous language of Tupi in his efforts of mission and conversion, based upon the hagiography of Santa Ursula and the 11,000 virgins. But it was also important to found these histories on a material ground. The city of Salvador received two heads in 1575. The first relics arrived in Brazilian territory. The beginning of this politically motivated major transfer of objects can be dated to the last decades of the 16th century. Of particular interest in this connection is the relationship between autochthonous, in quotation mark, relics, which were revered following the martyrdom of certain missionaries, and the imported bones. So this is also very interesting, and its lack of research as well, how these different kind of origin plays a role in the veneration. That is to say, the redirection of indigenous worship toward the veneration of saints and relics. In this context, it would be interesting to ask to what extent the production of artifacts should be seen as related to the production of relics, in view of the fact that the Catholic Church always made a connection between images and relics. And as was already implied in the statement by Böhme, this can also be seen as an eminently political issue. I'm coming now to Bartholomew of Braga. How can we understand the reception of the post-Tridentine concept in the Portuguese territories? In the following, one of the most important Portuguese theologians who also participated in the Council of Trent was the later Archbishop Bartholomew of Braga. Like in other territories, different synods were held, like in Porto and Lisbon in the 16th century and in Salvador de Bahia in the early 18th century. Also this, I'm commenting a little bit my own text, but because of the discussion yesterday. So we talked about the Council of Lima, and you see the difference. The council in Brazil is only in the 18th century. So we have a complete different history of this kind of question of to formalize these questions. So the text of Bartholomew, for example, plays a major role because there are no official synods and decisions that can be relied to. So these texts from the Council of Trient and those texts who participated are eminently important. Bartholomew should be understood as a parallel to Roberto Bellarmino in his efforts to establish a new post-Tridentine theology together with his practical manuals like his Stimulo di Pastoris or his Catechismo o Dottrina Christiana from 1562, which were republished several times and translated into many languages. His main work is organized in called Questio, which discuss all theological and liturgical questions. The debate on images and the worship appear in De Adorazione, De Sacrificis, and De Idolatria, which are our main questions. In his introduction, Bartholomew justifies the adoration of the images in opposition to idolatry. His emphasis lies also in his argument to show the parallels between sacred art and sermons. Important for his discussion is the distinction between an inner and outer sphere, which is important for the distinction between internal and external images. He doesn't call it idolatry when the same external honor is exhibited to God and to a created thing, such as a genuflection or prostration, so long as that action stems from an understanding that these acts differ in form, also they seem the same in the material world. His other direction to oppose the arguments attacks the Protestants, which is also important. I will come to that because the Dutch invaded especially Pernambuco, and so this is the direct contact between the Dutch and the Portuguese and the Catholic. In the question about the sacrifices, Bartholomew approaches the topic of the images and the external worship via another way. He opens the physical experience a channel. Like Bellarmino, he tries to construct a bridge between the scholastic tradition that only the intellectual knowledge constitutes an important value for receiving grace, and the physical and therefore emotional experience also creates a communicative channel for the individual believer. As main argument function that the sacrifice itself is a sign for the sensual experience. With this kind of reasoning, he approaches Bellarmino's and Paleotti's considerations that the adoration of the images constitutes almost a sacrament. Because of the proximity of the sacrifice to idolatry, Bartholomew tries to define the sacrifice more clearly by emphasizing that alone God would receive the sacrifice. He doesn't condemn as a crime of idolatry to kill a cow for the sake of a king as a sign of one's reverence and subjugation, just as it would not be a sin to offer living things to some lord in recognition of his power, which is very interesting for the Latin American context. His theory means, in consequence, that the sacrifice becomes a sign, an image, and the image itself turns into a sacrifice. Finally, he relates these aspects to the individual believer by describing it as an act of particular virtue, which constitutes the community, like Bellarmino and Paleotti have expressed. Also, Bartholomew includes his argumentation with an attack of the Lutheran position. In the larger context of superstition, Bartholomew explains with more details and theological apparatus the problem of idolatry. Apparently, this topic was fundamental within the missionary politics of the Portuguese church elite. More emphasis he puts on explanation which kind of worshipping saints would be idolatry and which do not. I don't want to go only in this theoretical debate, but perhaps in the discussion we can come back to this. So I'm coming now to the question of idolatry and conversion. In indigenous mission prophecy, and with its prophets, held enormous relevance. This matter relates to the status of the image itself, and I'm coming to this in my examples which I want to present, and its spacing. As Jesuit and Franciscan missionaries, in contrast to the situation found in Mexico or Peru, had not confronted idolatry similarly. This is, I think, the main aspect. While the different types of superstition and practices, therefore typical methods, did not work, Manuel de Nóbrega even declared that the indigenous people wouldn't possess any belief at all. Substitution of the right images, which we have seen the other days, or yesterday, I want to say the other days, no, yesterday, for false idols realized by the fusion and superimposition of indigenous and European models was not practicable. Instead, as Nóbrega related to Rome, missionaries encountered Caraibas who were called sorcerers by the European invaders. Therefore, the missionaries had to establish the idea of a cult image at all. In this context, it meant to bring together the idea of relics and together with the European concept of image and representation. As a linking bridge, the theater or the performing arts alongside the sermons of sacred rhetoric played an important role. Through the catechism theater, the indigenous population was to experience and learn the central contents of the Catholic faith in connection with the standards and rules of the post-Tridentine orthodoxy, especially as prescribed by the respective orders. Recent interdisciplinary studies between the theater sciences, ethnology, and anthropology show that the theater, or better performed representation, could be defined as social rituals of the early modern time. The observer participated directly and indirectly in the events. In Brazil, the plays by José Anchieta, which I already mentioned, written between 1583 and 97 of the mission near Tupi, form one of the most important examples of the early colonial age. The social, political, and religious concepts combine themselves in the performing action of the body. And this is one of my hypotheses, that we have in the early colonial time of question of mission and conversion, we find much more sculptures, which is a kind of related to the theater. And we don't have, as in Mexico or in Peru, paintings in this amount. In my opinion, the pure mention of idolatry in the text we find from the Jesuit and the Franciscans, together with human sacrifice, means something different than the first assumed lack of any religion or belief and anthropophagy. Despite the fact that the Jesuits later used the term idolatry, it didn't gain any importance before the Dutch occupation and their accusation of the Catholic Portuguese to be idolaters themselves. Several ex-voters, which unfortunately are in private possession, show the iconoclasm of the Dutch soldiers by invading the Brazilian... of Dutch soldiers by invading the Brazilian northeastern territories. The Dutch brought the conflict about the images to the Brazilian colonies, and with this transfer also the incidence of iconoclasm also strengthened the necessity for the Catholic Portuguese to show themselves not as idolaters. In this context, it was important to develop an image theory that goes beyond the dichotomy and shows its role in evocation of emotion response to the spectator. Now I'm coming to my 10 minutes. Okay, there will be less examples. In the 18th century, chapel of Saint Benedict is located near a gold chapel in the tertiary church of Jean Pessoa. On its upper level, the polychromatic altar includes a niche with the background painting of blue and decorated with flowers. I show you another painting, another example of Saint Benedict here. The sculpture of Saint Benedict follows the Brazilian iconographic tradition, which portrays the infant Christ in Benedict arms, thus linking the black saint with convent patron Saint Anthony of Padua. Despite the absence of the child, today we can imagine its posture of Benedict's arms. This is another example because my image which I had is gone because with my other computer. Sorry for that. It is important to understand the iconographic narrative discourse that forms the idea of the auto sacrifice of the so-called black slave saints from Sicily. The Franciscan Saint Benedict, this is the iconography in Palermo, the image, the painting there. In his hagiographical narrative on the occasion of Benedict of Palermo's beatification in 1743, Ermengildi of Rome relates that popular devotion of the saint emerged in paintings and prints in many churches immediately following his death in 1589, first in Sicily, later in Spain, and then Portugal and the Americas. Benedict of Palermo was born 1526 in Sicily as the son of Ethiopian slaves or emancipated parents, depending on the source. Ethiopia was assumed to be the origin of all black slaves. This is like a generic term. He joined the Franciscans of Palermo in 1564 as an observant brother. After several years in the kitchen of the convent, he was elected its superior in 1578, despite his illiteracy. Written testimonies by his Franciscan brothers included in examination of the early 17th century already reveal the main arguments for his sanctity. True and perfect Franciscan joy and cheerfulness were two of his main characteristics. Beside his happy face and ability to console, Benedict is described as simple, poor, sweet, and meek, lending him significant similarity to the innocent infant of Christ and his sacrifice. In spite of his enslaved parents' black skin, effigi nigra, and illiteracy, further testimonies also insist that his merit was an even greater indication of God's gifts. Parts of his body were sent as relics to Spain by the general minister of the Franciscan order and reputedly worked miracles, explaining the saint's immediate acceptance in Iberia. While lacking time for analysis of the Italian, Spanish, Portuguese, and French sources concerning his canonization, I would like to recall the post-Tridentine discourse of sanctity and the newly emerging models of the saint in the hagiographical corpus and narrative literature, beginning in the first half of the 17th century. One important example is the work of Antonio Dassa, Quarta parte della Cronica General de Nuestro Padre San Francisco y su Apostolica Orden, published in 1611 in Valladolid. Dassa aimed to demonstrate that a slave with a black skin could also be the instrument of divine grace and conversion. The centrality of racial characteristics, which extended to other black saints as well, is especially evident, mentioned five times on the first page only. The author evokes another black saint of the Franciscan tertiaries as Benedict's predecessor, Anthony of Caltagirone. According, and if you see the iconography in museums, for example, it's a complete mess. It's always Benedict of Palermo and actually, there are many different black saints from Sicily that are venerated. According to Dassa, both emulated the seraphic sanctity of Francis and his kind of auto-sacrifice. His love for the poor and hatred of the leisure. Hagiography places a special emphasis on his function in West Indies mission. In addition to Benedict's praise for all infidels, his images and miracles were to convert the New World especially. Indeed, Dassa explained, the New World would come to be like Benedict's home, new home. Of course, representation of Sicilian black saints were embedded in the political conflicts and wars between the Christian and Muslim worlds and courses in the Mediterranean. And now it's getting really tricky. Hardly isolated single cases, these black slaves, ex-slaves, converts and hermits were present among the Franciscan due to 16th century evangelization in Sicily as instrument of social integration. Conversion of slaves was the contemporary form of conquest colonization of the conscience. the Muslim Christian frontier ran from the Kingdom of Naples to the Canary Islands with the main outpost in Sicily. Corsairs sold many prisoners they took as slaves, but captives who converted to Islam gained opportunity of social ascent. These apostates, in quotation marks, 8,000 in Algiers alone in 1630, functioned as important early modern cultural mediators. But the church had to oppose Islam's attraction as a liberal, socially mobile religion, both to regain the renegades and to stabilize frontier societies. Thus, in a hagiographic narrative, Anthony of Noto is shown as a Muslim convert to Christianity, captured by Corsairs and martyred for refusing to renounce Christ. He embodied the dramatic conflict in the Mediterranean Catholic efforts to oppose Islam's spiritual and social attraction externally and integrate strangers internally as in a cosmopolitan Sicilian frontier society. Benedict, in contrast, represents the ideal slave, also Dasa, Santo Iota, a docile, trustworthy laborer, shepherd, and cook. On his first images, created from 1635 to 1637, which you can see here, Pietro Novelli il Monrealese, in Palermo shows Benedict with St. Louis of France venerating Francis. A cord joining the figure symbolizes the connection of the tertiary lay order with the first order. But this iconographic model was unsuccessful. Diego de Alvarez emphasized the importance of the saint images in a treatise in 1747. He describes the painting as the life of memory, light of life, testimony of times, messenger of truth, resurrection of the dead, immortality of fame and glory. But European and Brazilian visual representation also reveal a significant difference. Here, in an engraving, beside the syncretization, hybridization, so these are the models, this is St. Benedict in Brazil. I think I have another example. Beside the syncretization, hybridization, or more aptly, amalgamation of these black saints in written sources, we also find visual association with the famous Franciscan Saint Anthony of Padua, born in Lisbon. Read in context of the narrative tradition of Benedict's humility, this iconographical model suggests that blacks and whites in colonial society love and obey each other just as the white Christ loves the black saint, who humbly displays his loyalty. At the same time, we see emphasis on the differing skin colors and thus an aesthetization of this distinction. Read against the discourse of Benedict's humility, the group also demonstrates the moral value of a black saint following the church rules in a slave-owning society. Benedict was one of the most important saints for the black confraternities, in particular not only in Lisbon, but also in New Spain, Peru, and Brazil. Tertiaries played a major role here. Despite the devotion to Nossa Senhora do Rosario, they often took Benedict's name instead. Hermenegildo mentions processions and confraternal festivities in his honor, especially in Brazil. Despite his reports that the white and black populations showed equal veneration for Benedict, he notes the black, in quotation mark, nation felt a special devotion they could relate to him as one of their own species, one of themselves. His blackness, notwithstanding, Benedict still had the chance to become a saint. Also, according to Hermenegildo, divine providence facilitated the conversion of those nations by unique, appropriate ways and means suited in each state and condition. Hermenegildo also mentioned the idea of an appropriate path to conversion in discussion. The music, and I refer to the next speaker, in the solemnities in New Spain and Brazil. They made music in three ways: al modo spagnolo, al modo indiano, et al modo Ethiopia. Without discussing further the Afro-Brazilian King of Congo in Brazil, processions and their visual representations, there appears two questions. First, what is the visual and spatial context of the representation of Benedict in colonial Brazil? Second, did a parallel construction for the visual representation operate more widely? like those for the three modes of music. The first question should be appropriated by an analysis of two other spaces in the Franciscan convents in Paraíba, which I can't do right now, but I want to show it at least, and then I'm coming to my final, to the end. This is the example I showed in the exploratory seminar, which is also a question of sacrifice and the indigenous people. And I wanted to show you, so this is this kind of idolatry and question of sacrifice in the context of the indigenous in São Paulo. And I want to show you at least, this is the convent in Jean Pessoa. And also there, what I don't have the time today to show you, it is the it is this kind of a huge painting and isolating a history of St. Francis, which is completely unique. You only find it in Brazil. And it has to do with the indigenous, what I said about the Caraíbas and about the prophets. So it's a way to establish the idea of the image. And you know perhaps the history. So normally there would be the Jesuits around. And as you see, the Jesuits, and this is related to the mission efforts in Austria against the crypto-Protestants. So this is the context what I also wanted to show, but for the written essay, I have more time. But it is also related. So this is interesting. So the Franciscans are in their body under this image. So they represent as a body, and we had yesterday the discussion of the relation between body and image. So this is a part at least I wanted to show you, and I come to the last paragraph. The question of the image as a European concept represented in events like idolatry, iconoclasm, and conversion had to be introduced by the Portuguese colonizers in the 16th and 17th century. From the beginning, it shows its imminent political character, which culminates in the sophisticated texts of Antonio Vieira and Manuel Nóbrega. The lack of genuine idolatrous practices led the Jesuits and Franciscans believe that the Tupi Guarani wouldn't even have a belief at all. It is not by coincidence that the Catholic as well as the Lutheran and Calvinist authorities, when they ruled over the territories in East Frisia, I'm coming now back again to a very small area in Europe, as well as the and on the border between Netherlands and the Holy German Empire, found a religious behavior that seemed to be almost like that described by the Jesuits. In the modern historiography, it is called by various scholars as indifference, an alternative to the categories of confessionalization between Protestant and Catholic. The reaction of the cultural practices of the Tupi Guarani and the black slaves show the problem of the application of the dichotomous model of iconoclasm and idolatry and conversion, but also the necessity to understand the high complexity in the relations between apparently genuine European conflicts and the discourses in the American colonies, especially in the Portuguese colonies. Thank you.
It was a pity to tell you to come to the end. And now we already had some mention to the music, and we are moving to the next speaker, Philippe Conguillon. Philippe is professor of musicology at the University of Toulouse and a senior member of the Institut Universitaire de France. He has been a fellow here at Villa Etatti in 2005 and 2006. And at the Italian Academy of Columbia University in 2013. His work focuses on Italian music in the 16th century, with special emphasis on Florentine musical life. On this topic, he has published two books on Vincenzo Galilei and Andrea and Giovanni Gabrieli. He's also interested in improvised counterpoint in the Renaissance, with two publications, an edition and translation of Vincente Lusitano's counterpoint treatises, and a book on polyphonic improvisation in the Renaissance, published in 2015. And the title of his presentation is music as problematic means of conversion in the new world in 16th and 17th century. So, Philip, thank you.
Thank you, Carlo. I want also to begin with something to say about the kind invitation of Maria, and saying, first of all, that I am quite of an outsider here, a double outsider, because first of all, I am a musicologist, so in front of all these art historians, I feel a little bit isolated, and I will speak of the role of music, of course, in the process of conversion, so we won't have images here. And more importantly, secondly, I feel also an outsider because the new world is a new topic for me. I am completely unaware of all the sources you all know so well, etc. So I came, I've been studying this topic since 2 or 3 years at maximum. So I am still discovering all what you know very well. So I am very enthusiastic and say, but for you will say, okay, but this we know already so well. So I am I apologize in advance for all my own discoveries that won't be very new for you. And now I begin. Even if during a great part of the 16th century, most of the debates between partisans of the Roman Catholic Church and those of the Protestant Reformation centered on transubstantiation and the role of images, the place and function of music performed during the office also represented a point of disagreement between opposing parties. It is not difficult to understand why this issue was considered important. Following the humanist rediscovery of Plato and other ancient writings, the Renaissance firmly believed in the power of music to achieve wonderful effects on the human mind. To quote but one opinion, let us listen to Calvin himself, who was perfectly aware of the positive and negative potential consequences of the use of music. Among all the other things that are proper for the recreation of man and for giving him pleasure, music, if not the first, is among the most important, and we must consider it a gift from God expressly made for that purpose. And for this reason, we must be all the more careful not to abuse it for fear of defiling or contaminating it, converting to our damnation what is intended for our profit and salvation. But more than this, there is hardly anything in the world that has greater power to bend the morals of men this way or that, as Plato has wisely observed. And in fact, we find from experience that it has an insidious and well-nigh incredible power to move us whither it will. For this reason, we must be all the more diligent to control music in such a way that it will serve us for good and in no way harm us. Now, in treating music, I recognize two parts. To it, the word, and that is the subject and text, and the song or melody. It is true, as Simple says, that all evil words will pervert good morals. But when the melody goes with them, they will pierce the heart much more strongly and enter within. Just as wine is funneled into a barrel, so are venom and corruption distilled to the very depths of the heart by melody. If Calvin in this passage seems more concerned by the perverse effects of music than by its virtues, the circumstance that this preface was supporting Clément Marot and Théodore de Bèze's initiative to create a sung repertory of translated psalms testifies to Calvin's awareness of the positive action of music when suited to texts that did not use evil words. As a consequence, the Protestants soon developed next to the Psalms, which constituted their only liturgical repertoire, a whole body of chansons spirituelles conceived as, like this one, as a pious distraction and as an aid to private worship. But praising God in the vernacular was not a Protestant invention, however. From the 13th century onwards, the Franciscan and Dominican orders had built a whole repertory of similar devotional songs, known as laudi, that were very successful in central Italy and reached their height in the years when Savonarola was ruling Florence at the very end of the 15th century. One of the main characteristics of the Savonarolian lauda was the fact that these melodies were often not original, but borrowed from a secular repertoire that was enjoying considerable success, namely carnival songs or canti carnascialeschi. Because Florentine citizens knew these melodies well, Savonarola and his followers decided to adapt them to the new texts that served their goals. This practice, known today as contrafactum, was described through the expression cantasi come, or to be sung like. By this means, the writers of the texts intended to break the tight relationship between a melody and its underlying text in order to encourage the people to devotion. Music, then, was considered a particularly efficient tool for persuasion by both Catholics and Protestants. And this can be seen most clearly during the Counter-Reformation. As a last example before crossing the Atlantic, let us take the manual written by Diego de Ledesma, a Spanish Jesuit who moved to Rome toward the middle of the 16th century and made his career as a teacher at the Roman Collegio. His Modo per insegnar la dottrina cristiana, printed in Rome in 1533, describes a teaching method based on singing. The reason for this choice is explained as follows. I give the Italian text and I translate it into English, so that the children could learn more easily. And also those who do not read, those who have a poor mind, the rustic people and the women. Because memory is strengthened with song and learning is sweeter. And also because instead of the bad songs they are used to sing, they sing good and pious ones. This method was thus intended for a particular audience. And this is confirmed a few pages later. As we said, singing the lesson is convenient for rustic and ignorant people, and also for children. But if the pupils come from our schools, or if they are more intelligent and already know the text of the Christian doctrine, it is not necessary to sing in order to avoid boredom. Half a century earlier, the first friars who came to teach the same doctrine in the New World addressed an audience that, in a way, they could have characterized with the same words, rustic and unable to read. Of course, the difficulties they had to face were considerably harder than those encountered by their fellow friars who tried to get a fraction of the European youth back on the straight and narrow. But when addressing the issue of raising the Indian children in the Catholic faith, they used the same means described by Diego de Ledesma. Writing a report of their activities in November 1569, as you can see, the friars of the convent of Guadalajara explained that every Sunday and feast day, they would bring together the Indians in the courtyard of the convent in the morning to teach them the Christian doctrine in Latin and in their language, the Paternoster, Ave Maria, Salve Regina, and many more. Later in the text, we learn that the friars made sure that every evening, when the bell rang the toque de animas, the Indians would sing the Christian doctrine in Latin. This clearly indicates that they had learned it this way beforehand. So by singing, like Ledesma had explained us. But far from being restricted to a mere means of learning, music constituted a pillar of the general and religious teaching made by the friars, who dedicated their lives to this endeavor. The first and most famous among them, Pedro de Gante, who reached Mexico in 1523, did not conceive his educational program without this musical dimension. In a letter addressed to Charles V in 1532, after having said that he had worked to convert the indigenous people, he explained that he made them read and write as well as preach and sing in such a way that they had become, I quote, good writers and preachers, really fervent, and singers who could sing in the chapel of your majesty. And this has to be seen in order to be believed. The same year, 1532, another letter reached Charles V, sent by Fray Martin de Valencia, the leader of the group of 12 Franciscan friars who had followed Pedro de Gante a few months after him. Its contents similarly emphasize the role of music in their teaching, quoting both plainchant and polyphony. If music, even polyphonic in its most complex dimension, occupied such an important place in the Franciscan curriculum, it is not only because of its essential function within Catholic liturgy. The friars had also noticed how it attracted the Indians and thus made it easier to convert them. This idea can be confirmed by the letter of the Guadalajara Franciscans quoted above, who described how the offices were held. On the feast days with great solemnity, polyphony and music of shawn and flutes, all this attracts very much the Indians, as they say. But the most eloquent document on this matter was written by none other than the Bishop of Mexico, Juan de Zumárraga, in another letter written to Emperor Charles in April 1540. Experience has shown how greatly edified the Indians are by polyphony, canto de órgano, and how fond they are of polyphony in general. Indeed, and it's emphasized in red, the fathers who work directly with them and who hear their confessions tell us that more than by preaching, the Indians are converted by the music. They come for great distances in order to hear it, and they work hard to learn it and to become really proficient in it. This appeal of polyphonic music to an indigenous population that possessed the skills in singing and in playing instruments soon produced a proliferation of Indian musicians in the New World. Only one generation after the arrival of Pedro de Gante and the first Franciscans, the situation had become critical to the point that the first synod of Mexico, of the Mexican Church in 1555, promulgated a decree stating that the number of Indian musicians in the country be strictly limited. Apparently, this enactment did not produce the expected results, as 6 years later, King Philip II published an ordinance taking over the terms of the decree. Having been told, I quote, that the number of musicians and singers is reported to be increasing constantly in both large and small towns, the king took the following decision. We require a reduction in the number of Indians who shall be permitted to occupy themselves as musicians. If music and singing facilitated the assimilation of the Christian doctrine, and if the appeal of polyphonic music drove the Indians into churches, another means was considered crucial in the process of conversion: the translation of the original Latin text into native languages, and mainly in Nahuatl. as soon as they arrived in the New World. The missionaries strove to learn the local languages in order to facilitate communication. Translating the Latin text was considered a key asset in the process of Christianization. Indeed, this recommendation appears as the very first edict published by the Synod in 1555. One cannot, and it is a parenthesis here, one cannot by notice that precisely in the same years in Europe, the Catholic authorities were fighting to impose Latin against the vernacular as the only language to be recited and sung in church. This issue is often overlooked in the current literature. We could even speak of a schizophrenic attitude of the Catholic Church on this matter. On the one hand, all European translations of the Holy Scriptures were banished and put on the index, while on the other part of the Atlantic, antiphons, responses, hymns, and even the text of the Holy Mass were sung in Nahuatl or in other indigenous languages. In order to find a justification for this quite paradoxical standpoint, we have to move south to Brazil, where the Portuguese Jesuit Manuel de Nóbrega expressed in a letter the reasons for which the missionaries had decided to adapt the Christian liturgy to local customs. And he says, if we adopt certain customs of these people, which are not against our religious faith and have nothing to do with rituals dedicated to their idols, like singing songs of our Lord in their language with our music, and playing the musical instruments they are used to play in the festivals when they kill their enemies and they are drunk, it is to prompt them to abandon their other essential customs and, while allowing and promoting these ones, to work at eliminating the other ones. As good Jesuit, Nóbrega could not help but find a theological justification to this somehow bold strategy, claiming a few lines later, porque a semejanza es causa de amor, because likeness is a cause of love. And this is a direct quotation of St. Thomas of Aquinas, question 27. As a close reading of his letter reveals, not only did Nóbrega permit the translation of the Latin church repertory in local idioms, but he also accepted that this music be played on indigenous instruments, thus going a step further in the appropriation of the Christian worship by Indians through their own means of musical expression. Through this process, Nóbrega was confident that their old singing customs would be replaced by this new way of worshipping, and hence that they would forget their idolatrous religion. This widespread opinion was expressed by another Jesuit, José de Acosta, who in his Historia Natural y Moral de las Indias testified to the success of this method. And he says, our brothers who go to stay with these people have tried to set the subject of our holy faith to their own mode of singing. And the advantage of doing this is really great, because with the appeal of the song and melody, they stay all day long in listening and singing without being tired. They have also adapted in their language some of our compositions and melodies, like octavas and canciones, romances and redondillas. And it is admirable to see how the Indian practice them and appreciate them. This is certainly a great invention and very necessary for these people. And this is where we turn back to Europe, as the practice described here is very similar to the cantasi come tradition. But where has cantasi come moved texts and melodies from the secular to the devotional within the same culture? The translation, as you can see, into Nahuatl of Latin melodies and the adaptation of Christian texts en su modo de canto was a completely different operation that in the end would undermine the missionaries' initial goal. far from being a mere act of translation from one language to another, the nowatlization of Christianity, as it has sometimes been called, implied the transposition of concepts into a mode of speaking that was very different from any of its European counterparts. Consequently, the Spanish friars, from Pedro de Gante to Bernardino de Sahagún, decided to graft Christian concepts onto the original linguistic structures of the Nahuatl, thus creating texts that aimed at a better assimilation, but that could at the same time be understood quite differently by those who had a radically different cultural equipment. As Georges Baudot explains, I quote him, and translate and quote him, more than articulated sentences framed within a logical structure, Nahuatl uses groups of images or signified tightly bound by a ritual and traditional meaning. This is why Sahagún's sermons in Nahuatl, like this one, could favor the development of a syncretic vision by its listener. But what about the other method, that is, setting the original Christian texts in Latin en su modo de canto, in their own way of singing? In reality, the issue of singing this way was even more dangerous. And for reasons, and it will be my last quotation, explained at an early stage of the conquest by Bishop Sebastian Ramírez de Fuenleal, governor of New Spain. In a letter sent in 1531, Fuenleal noticed that before the arrival of the Spanish conquistadores, I quote him, among the Indians, instrumentalists and singers were highly esteemed because by means of songs, their musicians preserved the memory of the past, end quote. Because the very function of song in Aztec civilization was the preservation of ancient memory, we can understand why likeness as a cause of love could be potentially devastating. By approaching too closely the old customs through the use of Nahuatl and the preservation of the indigenous melodies and ways of singing, the Spanish missionaries created the conditions for a new interpretation of Christianity, in which Aztec religious beliefs could be incorporated into the new faith, giving birth to what Serge Grozinski has called the mestizo mind, that even today is a defining feature of the original culture of Central and South America. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this very interesting presentation. I already see many points of contact of discussion, but now we have a break, and yes, and we will come here. Yes, the coffee break. With a break with coffee. And we'll come back here in 15 minutes. So. Thank you very much. We're going to start. Our last speaker of this panel is Adam Jasienski. And we will see now that we are entering the very process of conversion as transformation. And it will speak also about conversion as a process of transforming things. And Adam received his PhD from Harvard University and is currently assistant professor of art history at Southern Methodist University in Dallas. In addition to having been a graduate fellow here at ITATI, he has held fellowships from the Center for Advanced Study in Visual Arts, John Carter Brown Library, and Casa de Velázquez. He's writing a book manuscript, provisionally titled Sacred Portraits in the Early Modern Hispanic World. And today he will speak about images of conversion and the conversion of images. Adam.
Thank you so much. And thank you to Vilaitatti and the organizers of this conference for inviting me. I was lucky to form part of the original exploratory seminar, and it strikes me how the opportunity to present the same project, though not inevitably not the same paper, a year later is quite rare. And so I'm very grateful to have the chance to revisit these same ideas with an expanded group of people. In writing a new version of this talk, I realized that it's directly thanks to the feedback of last year's participants that I've really nuanced this argument. And so just to mention a few of the comments that influenced how I've worked, Alina Payne and Maria Barbara pushed me to expand the very notion of what a portrait was, making it much more capacious. Carmen Fernandez Salvador helped me think of the inevitable gap that comes with working with inquisitorial materials that speak so richly about images that, for the most part, do not survive. And Byron Hammond and Jens Baumgarten's specific bibliographic suggestions were particularly valuable to retooling different parts of this talk, and they'll probably recognize that today as I'm speaking. By design, early modern portraits connote stability. Their efficacy as objects meant to communicate with and into the future depends, one might argue, on their static and unchanging nature. At the same time as depictions of actual individuals, often endowed with recognizable idiosyncratic features, they're supremely context-specific, both chronologically and geographically. What happens, then, when the people for whom the portrait served as a reminder, a source of comfort, or even a moral exemplar, all functions that Alberti had designated for this type of image are absent, either because of the passing of time or the crossing of distance. When portraits could no longer be recognized, they became blank slates, evacuated of signification and transformed from specific to generic. From the representation of one person, such a portrait became a representation of generic personhood, the sitter's individuality becoming subsumed to the universality, even if still bound by the characteristics of gender, age, and social status that the image could also convey. What remains for the image's later viewer, in addition to the potential for aesthetic contemplation, and that's really not my subject here, is an uncanny sense of presence, without the satisfying, the possibility of a satisfying resolution through recognition. It's in that moment of forgetting, that the anchorless portrait reveals itself to not be static at all, but in fact among the most mutable art forms in early modernity and becomes ripe for resignification. I show you a few such cases here, all of which I suspect to be examples of the posterior, later sanctification of portraits through the sometimes very simple addition of textual descriptors. The words San Jorge, St. George, and a cross on the armor of the figure in the portrait on the left. The words San Felipe Neri, St. Philip Neri, in the portrait on the right. And the halo of words around the head of the central figure that performs the double function of attribute of holiness and textual identifier as St. Bonaventure. In general, repainting has largely been ignored as a valid form of cultural production, often discussed in the literature on the conservation of paintings. But to focus on repainting as merely a hindrance to perceiving a picture's original appearance, whatever that might be, is to overlook an important aspect of its social life, of practices of perception, and of interactive, haptic forms of engaged looking. A picture of a veiled woman at prayer held at the Escorial further exemplifies the practice. On the one hand, this is clearly a portrait, a dramatic close-up that forces the viewer into direct confrontation with the commanding sitter. The artist has made no attempt to obscure the imperfections of her severe face. She's lined, jowly, with a wart on her left cheek. However, there are elements in the painting that contrast with its relative naturalism. The gauzy veil that frames the woman's face is weighed down by an ornate crown, outlined in thick black lines and richly decorated with pearls and gemstones. Along the left and right ends of the crown's round arc, there appear horizontal striations, intersecting with increasingly frequent vertical lines, seemingly drawn from a draftsman's toolbox for producing a sense of recession. In the lower right corner of the painting, three large iron nails protrude from between the woman's hands, which touch gently in a gesture of prayer. The nails lack much heft, balancing almost weightlessly between her fingers. Finally, incongruously, a string of dark beads cuts across vertically across the woman's hand, too close to the fingers to be a bracelet, but with no other apparent function or connection to the rest of the picture. It's these inconsistencies within the painting, the crown's cross-hatching and flatness, the weightless nails, the disappearing beads, which likely once formed part of a rosary, that reveal the image to have surpassed its original identity as a portrait. There's a paper trail to follow here that addresses the painting's duality. The 1577 inventory of the belongings of one Fray Lorenzo, in all probability Lorenzo Grillet, as he's described in the archive, a French embroiderer whom King Philip II invited to the Escorial. An entry lists, and I quote, a portrait of his mother, of Fray Lorenzo, un retrato de su madre, de Fray Lorenzo, which, given the ambiguity of the Spanish preposition de, either belonged to or was painted by the friar. When Lorenzo died in 1576, he was likely the only one at the Escorial to know what his mother had looked like. The principal entry in the inventory is annotated in the margin with the words, and I quote, this portrait was changed, se mudó, into the figure of St. Helen by order of King Philip our Lord, end quote. This line of text explains the nails and the cross, legible as iconographic attributes of the saint who purportedly found the relic of the true cross in Jerusalem as later additions to an already finished painting. As I mentioned, the amending of portraits of secular figures with saintly attributes at a later moment in those images' lives was a widespread early modern cultural phenomenon. As a result of such interventions, these newly repainted images came to exist in the interstices of seemingly well-defined artistic types, the portrait and the religious image. By virtue of their repainting, portraits of non-holy individuals could begin to receive and communicate prayers, catalyze penitential reflection, and in theory, occasion the strengthening or even awakening of a Christian conscience in anyone who saw them. Their conversion, in effect, made them into images that could convert. In the largely implicit hierarchy of image types in the early modern Hispanic world, the religious image undoubtedly stood higher than the portrait. In the 16th and 17th centuries, sacred painting was considered to be noble because its subject matter was noble. As Juan Luis González García, much missed by us during at this conference, has argued, a painting that was mediocre in quality but of a decent subject, decent as it's called in his interpretation, was inevitably, again, better than a stylistically excellent painting that communicated little of value. The portrait of a non-royal person, and it's important that this be a non-royal person, was enmeshed in the necessary narrowness of individual likeness and familial specificity. The superior category of the devotional picture, on the other hand, could positively affect infinitely many, as it would be appropriate for any person to engage with that image in a way that a simple portrait could not, and moreover should not, sustain. By ordering that the picture of the friar's mother be repainted, Philip II created an image that subsumed her individuality to the potential benefit that this new image could carry for any Catholic. The repainting I'm interested in here could happen because of the permeable inchoate boundary between the sacred and the secular in early modernity in general, and because of the lengthy imbricated histories of icon painting and portraiture in particular, for instance, as Alexander Nagel and Christopher Wood have demonstrated. When portraits were transformed into sacred icons through the repainting, they came into alignment with a plethora of other image types that could also simultaneously be read as portraits and religious images. In the early modern Hispanic world, as well as in other contexts, it was a common practice for artists to draw on the conventions of portraiture, the pose, background, naturalistic rendering, even costume when representing holy figures, as in Zurbarán's painting of St. Ferdinand or Antonio del Castillo's St. Blaise. Equally important was the verdadero retrato, the true portrait of a given saint, which often served as the basis for the more or less uniform corpus of that holy individual's pictorial representations. Finally, it was common for patrons to commission portraits of themselves and their family members as saints, known in Spanish as portraits a lo divino, This is likely the case in an anonymous painting of Saint Barbara from the Lázaro Galdiano collection in Madrid, where the penetrating gaze and individualized features of both the central figure and the puto, the angel, suggest that this may be a double sanctified portrait of a mother and her young child, which is a pictorial solution with precedence at the Spanish court, most notably in Pantoja de la Cruz's famous portrait of Queen Margarita and the Infanta Ana, represented as the Virgin Mary receiving the angel of the Annunciation. Proposed motivations for such images in the Spanish context have ranged from the sitter's supposed vanity to deeply rooted piety, but neither of these fully examines how such attitudes may have been articulated. Just as in the repainted portraits, where the loss of identity catalyzed what we might call the image's death and its resignification from specific to generic, in portraits a lo divino, too, there is loss at play. A portrait of a living individual represented as a saint may have indeed served to elevate that person, but more compelling, I think, is to propose that such an act subsumed, partially, their individuality to the universality of the sacred image. But what even was individuality in the 16th and 17th centuries? In Timothy Rice's framework, an early modern European person's sense of self was not necessarily dependent on one's body and by extension, therefore, on one's appearance. Rather, and I quote, it was above all fit with and maintenance of the multiple surrounding actualities that involved other people's senses of who they were, end quote. If we think of Alberti's definition of portraiture too, the identity of the sitter is always cast in relation to those who were or are around him or her. When a sitter asks to be represented as a saint, then, they subsume this densely networked relational personhood to the religious image's even denser universalizing network. They don't necessarily sever existing ties, but they create more ties, opening themselves up to an even broader relational community of Catholics writ large. Christomimesis is an obvious corollary when examining such sanctified portraits with Antonio Vieira's sermon on St. Francis, we heard about him from Jens just a few moments ago, providing an interpretive model for how to think of their patron's motivations. The negation of self, according to Vieira, was the only way to follow Christ, and I quote, "This is what St. Francis did. He negated himself to such an extent that he was entirely no longer that which he had been. But if Francis was not Francis, then what was he? He was Christ," end quote. Vieira turns to mystical theology, including the writings of St. Teresa of Avila, to further explain the process, noting that Francis undertook 5 contemplative steps in his becoming like Christ, beginning with his human state and concluding with divinity. These steps were, first, the annihilation of self, followed by conformity with God's will, transformation toward God, identification with God, and finally, deification, the last stage of God becoming. These steps range from human to deity, and therefore also from individual to universal. One motivation for the patronage of sanctified portraits was precisely such a desire for unbecoming, with the sitter taking the first step towards approximating the deity and the deity's universality. Like last year, in the second part of my talk, I'll discuss an inquisitorial trial that took place in the central Mexican city of Puebla in 1651. A witness reported to the inquisitors that he had seen a portrait in which the still-living bishop of the city, Juan de Palafox y Mendoza, shown here, was depicted with seraphic wings. The painter, who had supposedly made the painting, was summoned before the tribunal, where he denied ever having painted such a composite image and declared, and I quote, that another painter could have added the wings to one of the many portraits that I have made, end quote. Similarly, when later asked about the repainted portraits, Palafox himself lamented that he should be faulted for, and I quote, when a stupid or ill-intentioned individual adds whatever he pleases to a few of my portraits, end quote. Finally, another witness glibly concluded his testimony by saying, and I quote again, they have a saying where I'm from, when an ant grows wings, it's in order to die, end quote. This last statement proved to be prophetic. The portraits were nearly all subjected to a wide-ranging, officially mandated campaign of destruction. The images existed somewhere between simple repainted portraits and portraits allo divino, given that the memory of their sitter was essential to their efficacy. What I'm particularly interested in is how institutions like the Inquisition anticipated and policed the reception of such images. The Inquisitors, I suspect, operated under the premise that a supernatural attribute like a halo or a pair of wings could only be understood by its viewers as making a claim on the portrayed person's sanctity. Therefore, any image that was both a portrait of a recognizable individual and a picture of a saint threatened an ambiguous didacticism demanded of holy imagery. Elite audiences, however, were implicitly assumed to have the capacity of distinguishing between these layers when viewing such a sanctified portrait. Furthermore, we know that images such as the portrait of Queen Margarita as the Virgin Mary were displayed in semi-restricted contexts where they posed less danger to undiscerning viewers. Even if a sanctified portrait were driven by true piety, a true desire to annihilate the self, from the point of view of the Inquisitors, these potential motivations did little to assuage their concern. The threat the objects posed exceeded any virtue in their initial conceptualization. The Inquisitors were particularly concerned with the indigenous response to these multivalent winged portraits, given that, as one witness in the trial declared, these indios were, quote, a barbarous people with so little discernment as to believe in anything, end quote. Referring to the native population that lived in the towns surrounding Puebla as barbarous in 1651, 130 years after the conquest, is not unusual. But it reveals a concern about the persistence of pre-Hispanic modes of perception, value, and belief in the viceroyalty. This was a perennial concern in the Spanish Americas. In the Guatemalan town of San Mateo Ixtatán in 1687, for instance, the parish priest declared that the town remained Christian in name only. One of the Spanish witnesses in the Palafox trial declared that he had interviewed the indigenous owner of a portrait of Palafox in Nahuatl, which suggests that just a few miles outside of downtown Puebla, a markedly and self-consciously Spanish city, the portraits of the bishop, perhaps even some repainted portraits of the bishop would have been seen in bilingual or even monolingual Nahua communities. In these communities, can such language be seen as the vehicle for transmitting certain elements of a pre-Hispanic worldview this late in the colonial period? I'm not myself entirely sure, but if we entertain such a possibility, what elements of a Nahua cosmology may have differently informed an indigenous person's experience of viewing a portrait of the winged Palafox? Would they have, to borrow from Whitney Davis, and I quote, recognized the same overlapping or wholly different aspects within the same image, end quote. The concepts that we've heard about yesterday of Teotl and Teixipla from Aztec cosmology deal very generally with the idea that the divine is in some ways independent of the physical form that it comes to inhabit. The sacred force is known as Teotl, which is impersonal, while Teixipla is the physical earthly manifestation of that sacred force, what Molly Bassett calls localized embodiment. What a given deity looks like then depends entirely on the temporary form of the human actors who become it. In the Aztec context, any representation of the god Huitzilopochtli is actually a representation of the deity embodiment in the guise of Huitzilopochtli wearing his traditional costume and regalia. Importantly, these were often sacrificial victims, and these images of the deity in the Florentine Codex and the Codex Borbonicus represent such an individual destined for sacrifice, dressed in the garb and colors that would have made him immediately recognizable as Huitzilopochtli. To restate it differently, that individual became Huitzilopochtli, his or her identity was annihilated, to borrow from Vieira, in the process of deification. There exists, therefore, the notion that a human actor can temporarily give form to the deity through the act of dressing as that god. As Bassett pointed out, the tradition of making god bodies, as she calls it, affected not only initial encounters with Europeans, but existed well into the post-contact period. Even in Alonso de Molina's lexicon of 1571, variants of Te Xipla are described in terms akin to how portraits were described in Spanish dictionaries. Notably, the verbal form of Ixtlilxochitl is defined as, and I quote, to make something in its image or likeness. So how may have an individual who understood the concept of divinity through this aspect of temporality understood a portrait of the winged palafox? If the exterior appearance, the Te Xipla of a deity, was not fixed, then seeing an individual represented with the attributes of the supernatural may not have been understood as marking that particular figure's sacredness. Rather, to an indigenous viewer, adding angelic wings to a portrait of palafox may have simply been interpreted as an act of embodying a saint or deity, commonly understood as a manner in which the divine became manifest on earth without the actor becoming permanently sacralized. Indeed, as I've mentioned, when a person dressed as Huitzilopochtli, they manifested the deity while their own selfhood was simultaneously lost in the process. This loss of selfhood prefigures the later physical killing of that same person in ritualized sacrifice, as we've heard. A portrait of Bishop Palafox with wings may have then simply be understood as giving temporary form to the sacred figure. For instance, we can imagine St. Francis, who was often represented with the same seraphic wings that are given to Palafox in this case. This is an example from Cusco, but I think it visualizes well what such images may have looked like. These multivalent images may have been read by indigenous viewers not as claims of Palafox's sanctity, which was the aspect that most concerned the Spanish inquisitors, but rather according to the belief that any living individual could be an impermanent manifestation of a true deity, a sacred entity. The repainting of Palafox's portrait with wings may be read as an act with both Spanish and Nahua valences that placed the sitter into a relationship of temporary deification rather than usurpation of a saintly figure's privileged status. What such a perception shared with this perception of sanctified portraits with which I began the lecture with the talk was the loss of individual identity, either subverted to the higher status of the sacred picture in both repainted portraits and sanctified portraits, or subverted to the needs of the impersonated deity in the Nahua belief system. We're thinking about objects that are already complex and layered, rife with potential for misinterpretation. But in the context of the transoceanic Hispanic monarchy, attending to the vastly different ways in which different individuals may have viewed the same image is an attempt not merely to recreate a period eye or period eyes. Indeed, any of the American, African, Asian, or European individuals who also formed part of Pueblan society in the 17th century brought with them multiple individual preconceptions about such layered identities. I find myself wondering, therefore, about the potential benefits of even asking the simple question, always in the realm of speculation, of how the same image generated competing layered modes of reception. And I respond to myself that such speculation can generate additional understanding of additional motivations. In this case, for instance, for the rich act of repainting, which, as I've mentioned, was a largely overlooked but fundamental way of making new images in the early modern period. How can these cases productively engage with larger themes in the study of visual culture? At the moment, I propose their values not only in positing repainting as art making, but more generally by examining the flux in which images existed long after being finished, by situating instability rather than fixity more firmly in our understanding of early modern artistic types, and in this case of the traditionally hieratic category of the portrait. Furthermore, these cases center on period anxieties about the impossibility of effectively policing vernacular engagement with images in a monarchy that was expansive and diverse, as the Spanish one was. In their focus, I think, these cases engage with calls for global history of art that can be articulated through a careful examination of the local. I conclude, therefore, by suggesting that one of the main issues at stake in the various examples I've discussed is how universals, such as doctrine, law, orthodox imagery, encountered the specificities of local conditions. In this encounter, the universals are questioned, subverted, remade, and distorted, both in large centers and in small ones, both in elite and popular contexts. we might be tempted to read the addition of wings to a portrait of an ecclesiastic simply as a misinterpretation of an Orthodox image type, perhaps especially likely to occur within a colonial context. But attending to similar examples in Spain, including at the upper echelons of Spanish society, reveals that the processes by which such distortions occurred were varied, but always culturally generative. Furthermore, the frequency with which they occur leads me to think that the consistent distortion of downwardly imposed universals was part and parcel of the colonial enterprise. However, I think that it's not only horizontal distance between colony and metropole that we should attend to, but vertical distance, that is to say, the incommensurability of what the universal downwardly imposed tenet aspires to do, and the practical execution of that tenet at a local level, whether that be in Madrid, in Puebla, in Manila, in Naples, in Cusco. Such a perspective, I hope, asserts the dignity of the colonial while activating a wider set of considerations on the position of the local within the global. And as a final coda, I added this last night, how do we connect this to Florence in 2017? Well, when you're on your way to the airport after this wonderful conference, ask your driver to stop by the Fortezza da Basso, where you too can become a saint. Thanks very much.